Welcome back to Plug Life Television and to another episode of What Barriers Balancing the Rapid Charge to Electric Vehicles. Last time on this series, we looked at how to balance the grid when transitioning an entire nation's fleet of vehicles across to electric propulsion, and it turns out that it's completely doable. But what about all of the raw materials that are required to make those batteries? Are there enough elements to go around? That will be the focus of the next couple of episodes of this series. The first thing to point out when looking at raw materials is that there are no rare earth elements in lithium-ion batteries. The 17 elements that are defined as rare earth elements are highlighted in red on this periodic table. Compare and contrast the elements highlighted in green, which are commonly found in various chemistries of lithium-ion cell. Note that there is no overlap. The components of lithium-ion cells are a lot more common than many people think. So, what does go into a lithium-ion battery? Let's make a shopping list. First up, we'll need some copper to act as the current collector for the negative electrode, or anode. The current collector doesn't take part in the chemical reaction, but collects and delivers electrons to the active material, the electrode material itself, and acts as an interface between the electrochemistry taking place inside the cell and the electrical circuit outside the cell. For the anode, we'll need graphite to house the lithium ions. Graphite is just carbon. Of course, we'll need some lithium, but not very much of it. More on that later. We'll need a polymer separator, a plastic material that sits between the electrodes and allows lithium ions through it, but not electrons, thus ensuring that the electrons have to travel through the electrical circuit attached to the cell, and can't just form an internal short circuit, which would quickly discharge the cell, even with no input from the user. This separator will be soaked in an electrolyte to promote ionic conductivity, in other words, to allow lithium ions to move through the cell. The electrolyte contains a lithium-based salt for this purpose. Aluminium is used as the current collector for the positive electrode, or cathode, which is coated with an active material based on a lithium heavy metal oxide. Most variants of this contain cobalt. Lithium and cobalt make all of the headlines, so let's look at these in more detail. Let's start with lithium. For starters, the background image of lithium salts extracted from the vast salt lake Salar de Uyuni is far more representative than the images of mammoth open-cast mines that some people have in mind. Is lithium recycled from batteries? Originally it wasn't, but lithium-ion batteries themselves were recycled. Not for their lithium content, but for materials such as copper and cobalt, which have a much higher market value. However, with increasing emphasis on a closed-loop supply chain, combined with increasingly efficient recycling techniques, lithium is now recovered from lithium-ion batteries during recycling today. Will we run out? Absolutely not. There are 14 million tonnes of lithium on land, which is enough for 1.14 billion 40kWh Nissan Leafs. And if that's not enough, there are 230 billion tonnes of lithium in the sea, which is enough for 18.7 trillion 40kWh Nissan Leafs. Needless to say that we're not going to run out anytime soon. There are easily obtainable supplies of lithium close to home as well. There are lithium-rich brines down old Cornish tin mines. Portugal is the sixth largest lithium producer in the world, and Czechia sits on the fourth largest non-brine lithium deposit globally. That's all well and good, but will we be priced out by increasing demand? Again, no. Look at the market value of lithium today. If the value of that lithium was to quadruple overnight, the cost of an electric vehicle battery pack to the manufacturer would increase by only 1.6%, and this cost would likely be absorbed by the manufacturer. Plus, if the price did quadruple, then it would become economically viable to extract lithium from recycled batteries using even the oldest, most inefficient recycling techniques. As with any resource extraction, lithium is not without its problems. The Salar de Uyuni, in Bolivia, is the largest land-based lithium reserve in the world. Presently, a German company is commercialising lithium production there and placing emphasis on doing so sustainably. However, lithium extraction from salt flats is freshwater intensive and uses up to 65% of the local water supplies. Furthermore, the Salar de Uyuni is 125 miles, or 200 kilometres, from the sea. I propose installing a seawater desalination plant at the Chilean coast and running the desalinated freshwater through a pipeline to the Salar de Uyuni, also supplying water to the local communities along the way. The plant can be powered by offshore wind turbines and pipe-mounted solar. Looking at the feasibility of the latter, let's take the Panasonic HIT N340 solar panel, which is 1.1 meters wide and has a 340 watt peak output. This means that along 200 kilometres of pipeline, enough solar panels could be installed to provide a peak output of 61.8 megawatts, which, based on the efficiency of current reverse osmosis desalination plants, equates to a production of 30 million litres of fresh water per hour. Furthermore, the desalination plant itself concentrates lithium in the brine that is extracted from the seawater, which will make for easier production of lithium at the Chilean coast too. Indeed, there have been proposals to extract lithium directly from seawater using floating solar reactors. Next up is cobalt. The image in the background is of an old mining town in Canada which shares its name with the element. No prizes for guessing what used to be mined there. Is cobalt recovered from batteries today? Yes, for the economic reasons previously discussed. In fact, it's estimated that 25,000 tonnes of cobalt will be recovered from dead consumer electronics batteries by 2025, which is enough cobalt to supply 5.5 million Tesla Model 3s. Will we run out? The answer is no. In 2017, 60.5% of the world's cobalt came from the Democratic Republic of Congo, which is politically corrupt and does have human rights issues, but as consumers and suppliers have come to realise this, not only have supply chains in DRC improved, but supply from places like Australia and Canada has ramped up, whilst interestingly, supply from DRC has ramped down. I'll cover this in more detail later. Will we be outpriced by increasing demand? Again, no. If the market value of cobalt quadrupled overnight, then the cost of lithium-ion battery packs would increase by about 10%. But the cobalt content of lithium-ion cells is decreasing. Back in 2009, the most common lithium-ion chemistry was lithium cobalt oxide, or LCO, which contains 40% cobalt. Then, lithium nickel manganese cobalt oxide 111, or NMC111, came onto the market and was used by the likes of the original BMW i3. NMC111 means that the cathode contains one part nickel, one part manganese, and one part cobalt. As a result, the cathode contains only 13% cobalt, a 66% reduction versus LCO. Gradually, the NMC ratio was refined and the cobalt content reduced to the point that NMC622, as used in many modern EVs, had cut the cobalt content in half over NMC111. The variant used in the very latest EVs, NMC811, contains just 4% cobalt, representing a 90% cut in cobalt content of leading lithium-ion batteries in just a decade, and that figure continues to decline. Other chemistries of note include lithium nickel cobalt aluminium oxide, or NCA, as used by Tesla, the early versions of which contain just 6% cobalt, and lithium iron phosphate, or LFP, which contains no cobalt at all. LFP is used extensively in electric buses. Importantly, LCO is still used in smartphones and laptops today, so the cobalt ratio in consumer electronics today is 10 times higher than in the latest EVs. As such, recycling smartphone batteries properly will help to supply the ever-dwindling demand for cobalt in EVs. Promisingly, companies like Li-Cycle claim that they can recover up to 100% of the materials in old lithium-ion batteries. Before we move on, just take a moment to appreciate how little lithium there is in any of these lithium-ion chemistries. Tesla have been making some interesting progress regarding cobalt too. In China, the standard range Model 3 will be equipped with lithium iron phosphate cells from CATL, which are completely cobalt free, whilst the long range Model 3 will use LG Chem's NMC811 cells, which contain just 4% cobalt. US built Teslas are also seeing steep reductions in cobalt use. In 2009, Tesla used 11 kilograms of cobalt per car. By 2020, this figure had dropped to just 4.5 kilograms of cobalt per car. Tesla claim that the latest version of their NCA chemistry uses less cobalt than NMC811. Furthermore, Jeff Dan's research group, which works closely with Tesla, recently made an interesting discovery. It turns out that the cobalt in NCA, that electrochemists had assumed was required for thermal stability, was only in there for the ride the whole time, so NCA could go cobalt free in the near future. No wonder that Glencore has shuttered the largest cobalt mine in the world in the middle of an exponential uptake in electric vehicles, and reported a 44% reduction in cobalt production in its Q1 2020 report. So in conclusion, it's completely doable. There's plenty of lithium and cobalt to go around, and there are no rare earth elements in lithium-ion batteries at all. It's actually a surprisingly abundant shopping list of materials that we require. Plus, on top of that, all of the developments, not only in lithium-ion chemistry, but in novel next-generation cell chemistries, are moving towards even cheaper, even more abundant materials. Yes, there'll be some chemistries that are developed in the lab that have something like gold or silver in the electrode, but that's purely to prove the concept for this novel, new, particular kind of chemistry, which would then be further developed, and they'll swap out the gold or silver or whatever the contentious material is, whatever the expensive material is, with something else that's cheaper and with a bit of tweaking does the job just as well. And that's the version that will make it onto the market. So, I mean, that's even the most far-fetched new chemistries. You might get some which are a bit expensive, a bit rare sort of materials that are used, but they won't make it any further than the lab. And they are the building blocks, the foundations upon which we build these even cheaper, more sustainable chemistries as we swap out those expensive materials for cheaper ones. So there's nothing to worry about there. But we're not done yet when it comes to looking at balancing all of the raw materials, so stay tuned for the next part on the next episode of Plug Life Television.